Good morning, LifeGate. It's so good to see you all here this morning. We are going to get ready to enter into a time of worship together. If you haven't seen Pastor Larry, he's back here with us this morning. So I know we have some new families, and he has not been here since you've started attending. And so Pastor Larry is up here on my left. If you'd like to meet him later, he would love to meet you guys. But we're excited that he's here and feeling a bit better to be here with us this morning. I just wanted to share something kind of sweet. But a few weeks ago, or maybe like a week ago, I had taken my kids out for spring break, and we were driving home, and it was nothing like big. Like, we just went to Dave & Buster's, and we just had a fun day. But, you know, playing basketball with my son and playing video games. And we were driving home, I think it was, and out of nowhere, my son goes, "Hey, Mom, you outdid yourself." And I'm like, he's nine, okay? I'm like, "You outdid yourself." I'm like, "We just had fun, bud. We had gift cards. We went, we ate. We just took a whole day, just me and the two oldest ones. We didn't have the youngest, so they had my undivided time." And I've been thinking about that over the last week and a half. And this morning as I was getting ready, I just thought about how that, when we come into worship, do we come into that of like, "God, I'm going to outdo myself today. I'm going to be totally undone. I'm going to press in maybe like I've never pressed in before. Maybe I'm new to my salvation and I don't really understand praise and worship and the clapping and the raising of hands, but I'm going to give it all I've got. I'm going to give my full attention so that when I walk out of here, I know that I fully pressed into all that God had for me, and not in a way that it's about me, but in a way to say, I know that I held nothing back from my Savior, that I surrendered it all, that I received all he had for me in this moment on this Sunday morning in April, and to come into his presence today saying, I want to outdo myself. I want to worship like I've never worshiped before, not for the person next to me, not for the person behind me that sees me. You know, this team stands up here, and they're not putting on a show. They're leading us into the throne room of God, and it's not about them. It's about him. And so this morning, would you just join me? Would you stand? We're going to pray. And would you just ask God to bring you to a place of full surrender and openness, and a place of adoring who he is, all that he is. And I want to encourage you to worship him in a way you haven't before. If you've never clapped your hands during an upbeat song, just do it. There's a freedom that comes. If you've never tried lifting your hands because you think it's a little weird, I want to encourage you this morning to worship him in a new way. If it means it's just a little, that's fine. There's no rule in the Bible about how we worship. But there's a surrender that comes when we physically move and when we open ourselves and when we stand in his presence, when we stand on holy ground. So, Father, we thank you that we get to come into your church this morning, that it's not about us, that it's not about the team, that it's not about the person bringing the word, God, but it's about you. It's about praising and honoring you, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, our Savior, our Redeemer, our Healer. And God, we thank you that we get to come into this place freely today to worship you. So God, would we honor you in our praise this morning? In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, let's go. Come on. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise in the valley. Praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure. Praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when I'm numbered, praise when surrounded. Cause praise is the water my enemies drown in. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord.
you're still in control. My praise is a weapon, it's more than a sound. My praise is a shout that brings Jericho down. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to
praise the Lord. It says it in Psalms 156. Amen. In Psalms, it says, shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Break out in praise and sing for joy. Amen. We got to sing for joy. This is a time for us to praise Him, to worship Him. Our God is a God of breakthroughs. Our God is a God of miracles. Amen. Our God is a God of promises. Promises that He keeps. Amen. Our God is a God of love. Jesus, and we just got to believe that he just can do all things, right? Through Christ who strengthens me, I can do all things. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you. any trust in him? Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fortress in the fire, time after time. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood, and what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. My Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Perfect submission.
That's why I trust him. I saw the Lord. He heard and he answered.
trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior. My Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God. Thank you, Jesus.
Come on, praise Him, people. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him. I trust in God. And He heard and He answered. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, how many of you trust in God? How many of you trust Jesus? You can trust Him with your life. You can trust Him every day. No matter what goes on in life, you can trust Him. That's the God we serve. It's the psalmist who said in the Word, says, I sought Him and He heard me out of His holy hill. I sought the Lord and He heard me. He hears you this morning. He knows what you're going through. He knows the pain, the struggles, the difficulties in life. He knows all of that. But His promise to us when He left earth, He said, and I will be with you till the end of the age. He's not going to let you go. He's not going to stop caring for you. Regardless of what you do, He's not going to stop caring for you. You may stop caring for Him, but He's not going to stop caring for you. He died for you. He rose again for you, and He lives for you today. That's the Jesus we serve. That's the Jesus that gave His life for us, and that's the Jesus we worship this morning. He is our God. He is our God. He sent His Spirit to dwell with us and to be in us. He gave us the opportunity to be baptized by His Holy Spirit so we can walk in the truth and be empowered by Him to do what Jesus did when He was here on earth and what He still does today, He does through His people. That's why we can lay hands on the sick and see them recover. You say, well, how come, Pastor, you didn't get recovered, that you didn't get healed? I don't know, but I've sure witnessed to a lot of people while I've been going through it. I didn't get much therapy the other day on Thursday. She came out to do the occupational therapy, which is easier. She's not the one who kills my knee. She does other things to keep my upper body strength going and just make sure I'm able to do certain kinds of things and get around and stuff. But she's searching. And of our time we spent most of the time talking about Jesus and sharing with her who Jesus is and sharing her what it is to have a relationship with the God who loves us and cares for us. And she's searching. And I love that gal. She's a young gal. I don't know all the things that she's gone through in life, but, you know, she's searching. She says, yeah, I'm, you know, getting more spiritual. I said, well, it's not about being spiritual. It's about coming to know who made us and who loves us, who gave His life for us. And we begin to talk. My mom shared a testimony about God's healing in her life and what God did for many, many years ago. And you know, we're just receiving so much from God. And, you know, God puts us in different situations. And I'm not saying that, you know, God did this at all. Now, it's a lot of basketball on the hard courts and, you know, different things. And should have just played golf all my life. I probably wouldn't have had this, but that's the way it goes. I wasn't any good at golf when I was young. But today I'm wearing my Masters shirt. Today is final round of the Masters. Some of you, how many of you knew that? About five of you in here. Shame on you. Masters is the greatest tournament in the world. You know, today they're closing that out. But I did my best. It took me an hour and a half standing to get ready to come to church today. because I really wanted to be with you today. And I said, I don't know if I can make it, but I gotta try. As I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I, come on, Richard, play that again.
I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him.
Right there with you. Whatever you're going through today, he's right there with you.
I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
Praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hey, will you just turn to your neighbor for a moment and just ask them, is there anything that you're trusting God for right now? And can I agree with you in prayer? Will you do that right now? Take a moment and do that with somebody next to you. And if you don't have anything, just take a moment and just praise Jesus that you're doing really well right now. But if there's something going on, you got a family member, a friend, my supervisor, who put me in this church years and years ago, he's going through some stuff. He's been in the hospital, had an operation yesterday. Dr. Paul Jones, just want to pray for him. So Lord, in Jesus' name, make him well, and God, may this surgery just work and be strong in body in every way. And for my dear friends that are his family, who are like my brothers and sister, God, just be with them, strengthen them, build them up today, I pray. In Jesus' name, give them hope. Give them hope. Give them confidence to know that you're right there with them. In Jesus' name, hallelujah.
I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. Will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
'Cause what?
I trust in God.
Come on, praise him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, it's really good to see you all. I look forward to talking to all of you afterwards, okay? So don't run away. I really want to see you all. So God bless you.
Well, good morning. It's so good to see you all here again. If you are a first-time guest with us and you did not receive a Connect card, we want to make sure you get one of those so you can just slip your hand up and one of our ushers will bring that to you. We want to make sure our pastors can connect with you during the week. We can pray for you and your family. So if you did not get one, will you just slip your hand up quickly for an usher? If it's your first time here with us, again, we just want to say welcome. We're so glad you're here. Just a few announcements. As always, our groups are happening throughout the week. Tuesday night, ladies, we are here at 6:30 in the theater if you'd like to join us. Men meet on Zoom right now, the second and fourth Tuesday of the month, so that won't be till the end of this month. But just so you can plan for that, men, our youth meet Friday nights here at 7, and our young adults meet here Wednesday nights at 7. So we have a place for you to get plugged in wherever you're at. Our kids are going to be dismissed to the back right now for their time of learning about the Lord and just having fun, and I think they're working on some projects for Mother's Day and Father's Day coming up, so get ready for that. One more thing, since we're talking about kids, next Sunday right after church, we are going to invite anyone who would like to be a part of VBS, which is Vacation Bible School. Here at LifeGate, we usually call it Kids Week, but it's a week that we dedicate to having the church open, inviting all of our kids, their friends, their neighbors, your neighbors, our community to come and spend 5 nights just learning about Jesus through Bible stories and crafts and games and snacks and all of those different things that will just help kids start to understand who God is. It's a great outreach opportunity for our community, but also for your kids to step out and invite a friend who doesn't go to church to come. So we need people to make that happen. Pastor Ceci, our kids pastor, and her team need a bigger team. And so if you would be interested in serving in that, it is happening July 22nd through 26th. That's when Kids Week is. So if you can be available that time during the summer, we are going to do it in the evenings this year to allow the availability for more people to volunteer that do work during the day. But we are just asking that you stay next Sunday right after service for about 20 to 30 minutes just so we can get your name, your contact info, give you a little bit more detail about that. But you can help in any area. We've had people that do sports. If you love sports, like come hang out, play basketball, teach them some skills. We've got two of our hoops back up in the back, and so that'll be fun. If you love art, crafts, music, dancing, if you love to do drama skits, we can use you. We also just need security on the property, registration people, so you don't have to love to work with kids, but Jesus loved kids. And so we are asking you and inviting you to partner with us in making Kids Week a huge success this year. So next Sunday, right after service, join us. And then baptism, we did not have it last week, and it is moved to April 28th. So if you're still wanting to get baptized, you can see one of us after church, or you can go on the Church Center app. You can scan the QR code on the screen, and you can let us know that you want to be baptized. We have a couple that are going to do that, and if you would like to join them and you've never been baptized in water, fill out that form, and we'll connect with you. And then our last announcement as our ushers come and we prepare to give to the Lord this morning is that we are in the process, in the middle of doing a Heart Our Church fundraiser, and our church needs a new roof before the rain gets really, really bad again. And we are just asking you, as you are able, to give to your church, to help us put a new roof on it so we can keep this building up and in good stature and running properly and protecting everything that is inside of it. And it's just a great way for you to partner with us as part of your church. And so our church council put this fundraiser together, and they're just asking anyone who would like to partner. There is a spot to do that on the Church Center Giving app where you can just select the drop-down box and it'll say Roof Project, or you can mark an envelope at any time and drop in what you're able to give. And this is an ongoing fundraiser, so at any time you'd like to partner with us in that, we would appreciate that. And we just get this opportunity now to just give of our tithes and offerings, our 10% of what the Lord has given us. And so will you just join me as we pray? Father, we thank you that we get to give. We thank you that you are a good father, that you are a good provider, that you are faithful to your promises, and you always take care of your people. And so as we give to you this morning, and we thank you for all that you've given us, God, we ask that you would bless it and use it to reach more and more people with the good news of who you are and who you want to be for them. And as we give this morning, would you just help us to trust you? To trust you more and more with everything you've entrusted to us. So we thank you for this opportunity. In your name, amen. Will you stand with me? We're going to enter into one more song of worship as the ushers pass by. And then we've got Jason coming to bring the word this morning.
That you prepared for me.
and your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battles. This table that you prepared for me, the presence of my enemy, your body, your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. The valley. I'm surrounded by you. It
So we're here to fight some battles, and I can't think of a better way than to start this sermon by fighting some battles in this place. Heavenly Father, empty me out. Use me, God, how you want to use me. I pray the blood of Jesus over depression, over loneliness, anyone going through a bad relationship, anyone who's desiring a good, healthy relationship, anyone whose finances are low, whose spirit is down. I pray against the spirit of Antichrist in this place. God, do what you came to do. Holy Spirit, move through this place and change this atmosphere. I pray the blood of Jesus over you, your families, your next generation, the generation after that. God, I pray the blood of Jesus over our work lives, our home lives, our friends, our families. God, this morning we do not bow to the devil, but the devil bows to us in this place. The Spirit of God that lives in each and every one of us has made us more than conquerors. So we submit and we humble ourselves to the King. There is only one name under all of heaven that is worthy to be praised, and his name is Jesus. So we fight our battles this morning through the blood of Christ and by the word of our testimony. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm nervous. All right. Good morning, church. Nice to see everybody. Welcome to our guests. Welcome to everyone who's been here before. Give it up for the worship team one more time, you guys. It's nice to see everybody survive the eclipse. I thought the world was going to end, but you guys look pretty good for the world ending. I'm just saying. I just want to shout out everyone at home who's watching, my family that asked for the link. You know who you are. I just want to send a special shout out to my mom. She would be here. Trust me, she would be here. She was almost here anyway, but this past week, she broke her foot in three places, and that's what it took to keep her out of church this morning, but you can't keep her offline, and I'm sure she's at home judging me heavily because she loves me, and that's what she does. That's what a good mom does. She said, fix your shirt, baby. Stand up straight. Don't let them look at you like that. Oh, man. Thank you for my family who's here today. Love you guys. Thank you for the youth that are here that have shown up. Appreciate all of you guys. I see you. I'm always watching. If you don't know, me and my wife formally stepped down from youth ministry, and it has been one of the hardest things that we have ever done. But we are so blessed to still be in contact, and they reach out and just say, how are you guys doing? We miss you guys. And that means the world to us. So thank you, all of you. and this morning, I want you guys to hear from the Holy Spirit, not me. I am up here, but to be a vessel so that God can use me how he needs to. But it is the Holy Spirit that you need to hear from this morning. I am just a human. I am just a man. I am not perfect. But I do want to talk about someone who was. And so I just want to get into it because there's so much to cover this morning. And I pray that you guys are all blessed by this. But we all know that Jesus died on a cross. That's like the common thing. Everyone's heard the story, and we're not going to rush through the story, but Jesus was born of a virgin, fully man, fully God, went to the cross and died on the cross. And Jesus died for each and every person in this room. If you are in this room, and this is the first time you've ever heard it, I need you to know how valuable you are, how important you are. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world." But I'm going to make it more personal. "For God so loved you that he died for you." And I always, when I read that story, like we've gone through so many sermons over the last couple of weeks. We had Perla speak. We had Carly speak. We had Pastor Enrique speak. We had Pastor Bobby speak last week. We talked about how Jesus is the King. We talked about a Saturday faith. We talked about the Resurrection Sunday, the greatest thing we could ever talk about. And last week, Pastor Bobby said that sometimes you just needed to pick up your net and just drop it and go. And so this week, I don't have a title, but maybe the Holy Spirit will reveal one as we go. Because what I know in viewing and thinking about the cross time after time after time is that it wasn't this divine, heavenly, God-like spirit on the cross. It was a man. It was a human being. You ever get a splinter in your finger and it hurt real bad and you go, "Man, I can't stand this. I can't take this. This is awful." Could you imagine what that splinter would be like if you were hanging on it and people were beating you and kicking you? And so Jesus was this man who experienced the worst pain any human has ever experienced. The Bible says he was beat beyond recognition, where you couldn't even tell it was him. And I would have to imagine that it talked about how his mother and there was a group of women were just down the way and they were staring up at him on the cross with tears in their eyes. And if you've ever seen that scene in The Passion of the Christ, I could only imagine what it would feel like to be up on the cross but looking at your most precious loved ones watch you get crucified. And what possibly could be going through his mind at that moment? What would you think? What would he think? Now, it's amazing how we see how much of a human being God was. John 4:6 says he wearied as he was from his journey. It's like driving for 8 hours. And then you feel tired. Jesus felt tired. John 11 talks about how he was troubled. We get troubled. I feel troubled at work. I'm like, "Oh, man, I don't want another. Stop calling. What do you want?" You know. Matthew 4 says he was tempted. Anybody in this room ever get tempted besides me? I mean, temptation, that donut this morning, it was tempting. You know, I'm supposed to be on a diet. No, I'm not. Oh, but these stories are fantastic because they illustrate the humanity of Jesus. And a lot of people struggle with that idea that Jesus was God, but he was also a man. But that divine nature, the Bible says, he set that aside so that he could be a man. And for anyone who doesn't understand, why would God do that? There's a very simple explanation. Man made a promise that needed to be fulfilled, and we failed every step of the way. All throughout the Old Testament, God kept trying to give us chances, trying to make promises. "Come on, if you just do one thing, just keep one word, that's all you got to do." And we failed and failed and failed again, which is probably the story of everybody in this room. No matter how good you've tried to be, no matter how much in your heart you've wanted to change, you've wanted to give this up or stop doing this or stop thinking this way, stop being mean to somebody, we have failed over and over and over again. But when Jesus came to show us how to do it, but to also fulfill our end of the obligation so that our promise would be fulfilled through God. God loved us so much that when we couldn't keep our end of the bargain, he kept it for us. Amen? Everybody say, God keeps his promises. And so the next part of the story is Jesus goes to the cross, he dies, and then he's raised again. And I want to just jump into that because I really want you guys to understand what that means for each and every one of us this morning. So I'm going to go to Matthew 27, verses 45 through 54. I know it's a big chunk of text, but I love the word. I love scripture. And whenever we get into the word, it just blesses my heart. So I have a lot of scripture. So Matthew 27, 45 through 54. Now from the sixth hour, there was darkness all over the land. Bless you. Until the ninth hour. So this is 3 hours that have passed. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice saying, Eli, Eli, lema, sabachthani. I probably said that wrong. That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? And some of the bystanders hearing it said, this man is calling Elijah. And one of them at once ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink. But the other said, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come and save him. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Now, if he hadn't been through enough, people were still testing him. You ever feel like people are testing you in your lowest moments, in your darkest moments, when you are going through the world and you say, if this person tests me one more time, they got one more time. But could you imagine being on the cross and being tested? Let's see what happens. Like, this is not the time to play with me. I would be yelling at people from the cross. Like, if you don't get over here with that wine. But I think that in understanding what it means to be on the cross, Jesus knew that there was something greater to come. And it says, and behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook, and the rocks were split. The tombs were also opened. And I love this part. And many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the tombs after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. We have talked about Jesus being raised, but we forget that there were many others that were being raised. There is a glory for those that believed even before Christ came. When the centurion and those who were with him kept watching over Jesus, saw the earthquake and what took place, they were filled with awe and said, truly, this was the Son of God. And I've actually had a lot of questions or conversations with people that have asked the question, why did he have to die? And he had to die to fulfill the sacrifice, the need for the sacrifice. There was a need for blood to cleanse us all, to atone for the sins that we created. And what the Jewish culture used to do is they used to offer up the most perfect sacrifice that they could to atone for sins. And this is the significance of why it matters that Jesus was sinless. Because as a man, he was perfect in his ways. And because he was without blemish, he fulfilled the perfect sacrifice. So why did he have to go to heaven? Well, John 16:7 says this. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. That is the promise of the Holy Spirit coming for each and every one of us. The same Holy Spirit that led Jesus, the same Holy Spirit that had him do miracles, the same Holy Spirit that he surrendered to before he did anything is the same Holy Spirit that lives in you. John 14:2-3 says, in my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have not told you that I go to prepare a place for you? Let me pause for a second. And if you just think about it, think of being invited to like Elon Musk's house. You would think, man, that guy probably has a huge house. It's ridiculous. It must be really nice. There's all kind of stuff. Like, what does his bathroom look like? Does he have two sinks, one sink? Does his one faucet, the drop-down shower? There's all these thoughts, right? Okay, let me give you a better perspective. What does God's house look like? Imagine what his bathroom looks like. There's no sink because everybody's clean already. Washed in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right. But that's awesome, because not only did he go to heaven to prepare this place for us, like imagine you go to heaven and God's like, you ready to go see your room? I'd be like, move. I want to see, you know. And it's incredible because we get to go to heaven. There's no reason to fear death because when we die, we get to go to heaven. Anybody ever get to go to Disneyland? Heaven's 100 times better. I'm just telling you right now. I'm sure they have a short line for the churros. Just. But now that he's risen, what does that mean for us? And I really want to take a second to think about this, to talk about this. Because in everything that we've experienced, there is so much more for each and every one of us. But if we never think about it, it makes it really hard to receive what is next for us. And so this morning, I wanted to take a second and just talk about the gospel, because we use this phrase all the time in church, and I like to call it churchanese, because to anyone who's new in church or coming in from outside of church, we say the gospel is this, the gospel is that, and you hear about all these gospels, but there is only one gospel. And let me tell you that right now in the world, there are many gospels that are false. There's a social gospel that says we can rebuild the world and make it into paradise. There's a prosperity gospel that says if you reap, you will sow. And if you give all of this, then you will receive all of this. And it becomes about what you receive. There is a hyper grace gospel that says no matter what I do, God will forgive me and I will be saved. But there is only one gospel. And the thing about the gospel is this. The gospel is about Jesus Christ. The further you move away from Christ, the further you are away from the gospel, from the truth. And the gospel is what saves. The gospel is the power unto salvation. And I just want to share with you that the gospel is the good news of Jesus Christ. So anyone who claims to witness and give the gospel but leaves Jesus' name out of it is not the gospel. 1 Corinthians 15:1-4 is the perfect description of the gospel. And there was a time where all the church leaders gathered together, and maybe if you've spent any time on the internet, you might have heard. But there was this council of Nicaea, and they all gathered together to determine what the gospel was. And I love to sum it up in 5 points. Jesus was born of a virgin. He was fully man, fully God, and he was sinless. He went to the cross and died. He rose from the grave, and my favorite, he's coming again soon. That is our promise. That is that part of the scripture that gets left out in some churches. We believe that Jesus is coming again. So no matter if the devil walked in this room and everybody went, oh my goodness, Jesus is coming right behind him. You better watch your back, devil, because it's going to happen. And I love Romans 1:16. Romans 1:16. Let's go ahead and put that one up. Romans 1:16 says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation." Anybody in this room have a family member that they want to see saved? We do it through the power of the gospel. Many people come to church and ask, okay, I got to get my son saved. He's drinking and doing drugs and doing all this stuff. But when he understands what the gospel really means, there is no reason for him not to get saved. To finish, it says, to everyone who believes, first the Jew and also the Greek. And what this is basically saying is that there's not a single person in this room. This room is very diverse. We have every nation, race, creed. And God loves each and every one of us the same. At one point, the Jews were the promised people. Then God reached out to the Gentiles. Then God said, whoever else is left, all y'all get into heaven. You guys are all promised children. You are all my children. You come in on this side. You come in on that side. And what the greatest part about it all is, I can't think of anybody who he invited in that was perfect. This is not a message of judgment this morning. If you walked in here with shame, shake it off, because God does not believe in shame. He believes in redemption. He believes in redeeming people to what they were supposed to be. So this morning, the point of Jesus coming as a man was to give us an example of what we were supposed to be. The point of him going to the cross is to fulfill the promise of what we could be so that we could be it. And so time after time, you come to church and we preach rules. We preach, don't do this. Stay away from that. Don't touch that. But I'm here to tell you something. It is finished. And if you don't understand what that means, let me read this quote from Charles Spurgeon. Human nature's way of salvation is do, do, do. But God's way of salvation is done, done. It is all done. You have but to rely by faith on the atonement which Christ accomplished on the cross. And it is already yours. Do we try to change? Do we transform in his presence? Do we surrender and submit to who he is? Absolutely, because it changes us on the outside. But what is on the inside is what we are asking and surrendering to Christ, and we're saying, God, you can have my heart. You can have the whole thing because it's so messed up. It's so jacked up. And I need you to have my heart, because if you have my heart, I don't answer to anybody except my mentors. But God, if you have my heart, I know that you're going to help me. And I want to reiterate that. Because the life of a Christian is about transforming into the image of the one who created us in the first place. In Genesis, it says that God said, "Let us make man in our image." It wasn't just so that we could look like God, which a lot of people think, that we were supposed to resemble him physically or maybe spiritually. But when Jesus came, he was what we were meant to look like. He is what we are to resemble in our daily lives. When we walk, when we talk, when we think, in our hearts, Jesus is what we were supposed to be from the very beginning. And even though we fall short, God still loves us. All we have to do is repent. All we have to do is call on his name. All we have to do is welcome him into our hearts, because the change happens from the inside out, not the outside in. So many times we can focus on the outside. You need to come to church. You need to read your Bible. You need to pray. And if we see that, we don't say a word to people. But what if on the inside they have the darkest feelings, the darkest emotions, the darkest pain? The only one who can get to that is Jesus. So Jesus gets to the inside and he starts to change your desires. I want to share a story with you guys, and this is a little personal, because this is what brought me back to Christ. So let me humble myself and just share how messed up and broken I was. I had just had an accident at work. And I had to get surgery on my finger. And I was hurt really bad. I was going through a bad breakup. I was in the middle of fighting with family. And I felt as low as I could be. And I smoked weed. I drank all the time. And there was a day where it just did not cover the pain anymore. And I knew in my heart that I had been missing something. And it dawned on me that I had not been to church and I had not been in God's presence. And one day my finger was hurting after the surgery. And as weird as this sounds, I go to my best friend. And my best friend is drinking and smoking too. And I said, "I need you to pray for me right now." And he looked at me and said, "You sure about that? I got this beer in my hand." And I said, "Yeah, I do. But I know that if you pray, I will feel better." And so I go into his room and I just raised my hands like that, and he started praying. And my finger felt better. So just like a lot of us, immediately I'm like, "Sweet, all right, I got what I needed. Thank you, God." Walk into my room, and I picked up the can and took another sip. Immediately right back into the sinful life that a lot of us experience. And I kid you not, my finger felt like someone took it and ripped it off the other way. And it had to be something spiritual, because I'm like, "Whoa, this does not feel right." So I go back into my friend's room, and I said, "I need you to pray again." And he's looking at me like, "What are you talking about?" And this was the moment that I surrendered to God with everything that I had. I just said, "God, I need you now more than I've ever needed you in my life." And just like these spotlights opening up, I felt like a light open up in that room. Something was taken off of me. Something pulled everything off of me. And despite the fact that I was drinking and smoking at the time, I opened my eyes and I was sober. And I have not had the desire for either of those in the same way since. And eventually that led me back to church. That led me back to this place. That led me to the point where I was like, "God, I just need you more than I've ever needed you." And I say that every day, all the time, because the gospel is not for the sinners who are not saved. The gospel is for us who are saved, who need transformation, who need God to change us in a new way in this place this morning. It's not for just those who are doing bad things now. It is for us who are chasing after God, because the gospel is the good news for us. But if we don't know that, if we don't trust that the gospel is the good news for us, then it's just for them. But it's for me. I would not be up here today if it was not for the gospel. I would not be transformed in a completely different person. I would not be a good husband. I would not be a good son, a good brother. I would not be a good cousin. Any of that, if it were not for me surrendering and submitting to the gospel daily. I still sin daily, so I can repent daily. And I need the gospel that Jesus Christ was a man to remember that that's what I am. That's what I need to be. And so I just thank you, God, this morning for chasing us down, pursuing us until we opened our eyes, pursuing us until we opened our ears, till we finally listened. You never went away. We went away. God, you love your children so much. You would chase us in the street. You would chase us into a drug house. You would chase us when we are in jail. God, you don't care what we've been through. You care where you can take us. So this morning, wherever you are, let God take you to where you need to be. And maybe this morning you've allowed your experiences and the things you've gone through to be your identity, to tell you who you are and what you've been through. But you weren't created for that. It's not the truth of why you were here. You weren't here to be beaten, to be abused, to be cheated on, to be disrespected, to be lost, to be a drug addict, to be an alcoholic, to cuss, to do all the things that we can do. You were created to be a child of God. You were created to be love that resembles the Father for your friends, for your family. That's why we have on our logo, love people. Even when it's hard, and I understand that it gets hard. I drive in LA traffic. I understand it can be hard to love people. But that is what we were called to do. And if you're not that today, that's okay. Because today and for the rest of your life, God will change you into the love that he has called you to be. He will restore your purpose. You can forgive those who have hurt you. You can forgive those who have mistreated you. You are free. And I ask Jesus to break every chain of backstabbing in this place. I ask Jesus, by the blood of his sacrifice, to free my brothers and sisters this morning. I'm going to ask the worship team to come. Sometimes I get convicted because I can sit in church just like anybody and I can just go through the motions. And then a song will come on like the Heart of Worship and says, when the music fades and all is stripped away and I simply come longing just to bring something that's of worth. Jesus died on a cross for each and every one of us, and all I want to do is bring something that's of worth to him. So I'm coming back to the Heart of Worship because it's all about him. And if we leave out the true gospel and we forget that it's all about him, we can sing that song and it doesn't mean anything. Jesus didn't die for the bad people. He died for everybody. And so this morning, I don't know how you see yourself, but I'm going to invite everyone to close their eyes and bow their heads. And I'm going to ask, if you're in this place, if you're in this room, and you see yourself unredeemed, far away from God, lost, broken on the inside, carrying scars from your childhood, and you've never given your life to Christ, you've never had that moment where you just gave it all to him and you surrendered and you said, God, I need you now more today than I ever have before in my life, then I'm going to invite you to pray with me. I don't want you to say the sinner's prayer. I want you to speak to God from your heart. There's no right way to do it. Just talk to him like a person. God, this morning, we come before you and we ask that you would be here with us. Be here with me. And forgive me for the wrong that I've done. Forgive me for the wrong that I will do. Forgive me for the stuff I don't even understand that was wrong. But God, I know I need you today. So God, because I need you, will you come? Will you meet me here? Maybe you're in this place and you've been away from God, but you know God. You've given your life. You are dedicated. You've made the commitment. You've said yes, and you're ready to move forward. You've been moving forward for years. But lately, in these last couple of months, something's just got you weary, and your spirit's down, and you feel defeated, and just, God, what is going on? Well, this morning, and I'm going to ask everybody to repeat this. Heavenly Father, thank you for your sacrifice for me. This morning, help me transform to be more like you. Thank you, God, for all that you've done for me. In Jesus' name, amen. So this morning, if either of those apply to you, I'm going to invite you to do one thing. Don't clap for me. Don't tell me how good of a job I did. Give the one praise who deserves all the praise. Thank him, raise him, and as we sing one more song, I'm going to invite you to come down if you need prayer. I'm going to invite you down if you need to know the next steps. I'm going to invite you down if that scar that you had when you were 5 or when you were 7 never healed, and you need to get down on your knees and you need to say, Jesus, I need you to take this away from me. There is pain in this room. I can feel it. There is hurt in this room. I can feel it. Somebody cannot forgive the backstabbing and the betrayal of somebody else, and you just don't know what to do anymore. Well, I'm going to invite you to come down. And as we sing this song, I don't care what it is that you are experiencing. Worship God. Trust him. Because the greatest thing we can do is bow now. Because one day every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Whether they want to or not, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that you are Lord and that you are great, God. Great is the Lord who has come this morning, who has changed the atmosphere in this place. And we thank you, Lord, that you are always good, that you always love us, and that we always matter to you. Thank you, Jesus.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the dark.
Will you come?
And great I am, Lord.
These altars are open.
It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you, Holy. Es tu aliento en mi ser. Y te damos honor. Te damos. En mi ser, y te damos una solo a ti.
Jesus is calling.
Great I am, Lord. You give life, you are love. You bring light to the dark.
So I'm going to pray that the anointing of the Holy Spirit falls on you as we sing this next part. We don't sing this timidly. We sing this in victory. So this morning, let us open up our hearts and let us sing with all we got. Hear it. Let the darkness fall.
Pour out our praise, pour out.
So this morning, with these altars open, maybe there's some hearts in this place that are just a little heavy and a little hesitant, but you know God is calling you. Maybe your life hasn't been what it's supposed to. Maybe it hasn't looked exactly like Jesus. Maybe you know you're falling short of the glory and you've gone too long without repenting. And you don't want anybody to pray for you, but you just want to spend a moment with God. These altars are going to stay open. They're always open. This church loves you. This church is here to serve. We have many leaders who serve constantly, weekly. And if you pick up a phone and call, somebody will call you back. But I'm going to invite you. If you need it, it's here. And this week, as you go, I just want you to be blessed because we have a Savior who went to the cross just for you. And when the devil tries to test you, because he will, remember that your Savior died for you on the cross. And rejoice because it is finished. It's already been done, all of it for you. So receive it this morning. Take it with you. Don't walk out of church and just go, oh, that was a good sermon. Walk out of church in victory by the blood of Jesus. I speak this prophetically. There's families in this room that are going to be restored. There are people in this room that are going to break addictions. There are things in your lives that are going to leave in the name of Jesus because they do not belong. So praise your name, Jesus. And everyone have a blessed week. Amen.